At Council Bluffs Savings Bank, our goal is to help you, your families, and your businesses grow and prosper for generations. We take pride in our community, whether it's volunteering our time or helping individuals, families, and businesses succeed. We provide you with the personal service and attention you deserve. With over 220 years of banking experience, decisions are made locally. We are Council Bluffs people operating at Council Bluffs Bank to help Council Bluffs be a better place to work and live. Council Bluffs Savings Bank, hometown banking the way it used to be. Member FDIC.
First up is Art with results from the general obligation bond bid results.
Bonds. I am very pleased to report that the city has received the most bids in my knowledge over the last 7 to 8 years. 11 bidders came to the table to try to purchase the city's bonds today, which created a very competitive environment. So happy to report that the winning bid was received from FTN Financial Capital Markets. They are out of Memphis, Tennessee, with a true interest cost of 1.99%. So that means the city just borrowed $7.6 million for the next 12 years at less than 2%. Excellent, excellent rates. As far as pricing goes, we did seek a rating from Moody's Investor Service. The city's credit rating has been affirmed at AA2. And just a reminder that the highest credit rating is AAA, and then it steps down to AA1, AA2, AA3, single A1, single A2, and single A3. So very highly rated credit for the city. We did sell bank qualified bonds. That means that we told the market we don't intend to spend or to issue bonds in excess of $10 million this year. Based on that, there is a little bit of a pricing benefit for banking networks to participate. So you'll see the cover bid did come from UMB Bank. They're a large banking network that participates heavily in the Midwest out of Kansas City, Missouri. There were 11 bids we received. That includes 35 firms. So there were syndicates and other firms that joined with groups together. So you'll see as you flip through the pages, Robert W. Baird out of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, they tend to run the biggest syndicate. There were probably 20 bidders maybe there alone. So very strong interest, very strong demand. We were pleased with the affirmation of the city's AA2 credit rating. I will say that Moody's recently reevaluated and modified their methodology for general obligation credits, which has resulted in some downgrade actions across the state recently. And so we're very pleased that that the city was able to maintain their AA2 rating. Does anyone have any questions for me? All right, well, with that, I would recommend that the city would issue and award the bonds to FTN Financial Capital Markets at a true interest cost of 1.99% tonight.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, item B on the agenda is the Convention and Visitors Bureau Strategic Planning Review update.
My name is Kathy Fiscus. I live at 210 Traders Point Circle in Council Bluffs. Thank you for your time today, Mr. Mayor and Council. It was sometime in the fall that the Council recommended to the new Convention and Visitors Bureau Board that they would endorse hiring a consultant to work on a strategic plan, which did indeed occur in mid-January. I feel comfortable telling you some of the things that are emerging from that plan. The CVB board is yet reviewing all 18 pages of the consultant recommendations. There are three main themes that I would tell you about. One is to be relevant. The community wants the Convention and Visitors Bureau to be relevant, which means to have a new website, to be mobile, to be online, to be in the know, to be involved. So there's a lot of new going on there. We will be known as Travel Council Bluffs. We tried to secure the URL, Visit Council Bluffs. That was unavailable. So we secured Travel Council Bluffs. Many convention and visitors bureaus of late are going by their URL. I tell people that Dublin, Ohio has a website of irishisanattitude.com. So going by Travel Council Bluffs kind of is an invitation and explains a little better what we do. A lot of people have said CVB with bureau in there, it seems bureaucratic. So we're we're going to have a lot of new to be relevant, to be communicative. And that's why I'm here with you this afternoon, to develop a message to explain the value of tourism as one of the objectives that the strategic plan suggests. The other is to create a collaborative vision for our community and for the area. We've already met with hotels, we've met with attractions, we've met with some of our volunteers. I'm personally meeting with all of the survey respondents who gave us at least a half hour of their time to try and walk through and communicate better, and that will continue. And then the third theme is to be a convener, to encourage and share and work together. There are lots and lots of small community organizations that have a great passion. We sense a lot of energy. If we can get some collaborative effort between those folks, then there's more power in the numbers there. And then we are encouraged to participate in major events and development of things that could brand the community. So the Zeitgeist plan, of which I believe you were forwarded in your packet, has goal one is to communicate and refine the sales and marketing of Council Bluffs. Goal two is to increase the community outreach and have a shared vision for Council Bluffs. And goal three is to support destination enhancement development, which is kind of placemaking and event making. I would refer to you at some point to peruse pages 11 and 12 of the information that was given you. The web page is a key element. So I have here, if you're interested, you can stop by my office at some point. These are what they call mock-ups of the new website, but tons and tons of pictures and a lot of engagement. After the mayor spoke with the board of directors, we have search on the main page, a calendar of events that'll go a long depth and have searchable capabilities, so a mom at home or someone at the office can say, well, what's going on in August, for example, as well as we have on the main page three engagement areas for a featured story, upcoming events, and calendar of events. One of the things I'd like to point out as well is, I don't know if you've received the Mid-America Center lineup for April and May, came into my inbox today, but that's the kind of things that we would turn around and put on our website. They are loaded, and if you haven't seen that, you'll be very pleased that they're very busy. We intend to turn that around and reach out to those persons who would be on our website and do that as well. So what's coming up? Obviously, the Gambler is coming up really soon, but I'll point out something that this is kind of an announcement, and that is the Epic Iowa Road Trip will be here overnight for May 9th and 10th. We were successful in attracting the Iowa Motor Coach with travel writers and media personnel that will be going from river to river. We attracted them to stay overnight here rather than in Sioux City. They'll stay overnight here and then end up in Sioux City, but they'll be here for the Celebrate CB opening with the barbecue contest and so on, and then do some attraction viewing in the morning before they go on. Iowa League of Cities will be here September 23rd, and the Iowa Tourism Conference is October 22nd. Not to overlook Lustfest. Lustfest will begin, obviously, May 25th. We are participating. We brought to Lustfest the Extreme Obstacle Challenge on May 31st. So there are lots of things that are coming up that have a pretty good profile for the city itself. Wednesday, Josie and I will go into Des Moines this week to bid on Iowa League of Cities for 2016. And then Friday and Saturday, we will be in Burlington to bid on the Men's Bowling Congress for 2018. That's a huge piece of business. I hope we can bring that home for you. It would represent 400 male bowlers every weekend from February through mid-May. So we want to bring that home. If you have any questions, do it now or call me later.
Any questions for Ken?
Can I look through the, can we just pass those through the website?
Certainly, and I have a sample of the online visitor guide and a hotel piece.
Okay. So I'll get these back to you before you leave.
Sure. Thanks, Kathy.
Thanks, Kathy.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Shannon and Tony?
No, just me. There's Matt.
All right.
This is my favorite time of year.
Well, good. I'm glad. And they all got voted excellent this year and got them back to us in a timely manner, which was awesome. So thank you. We appreciate that. It was our third annual year for the Celebrate Recycling Contest. We had 12 schools, just like last year, only 22 entries, two less. Two schools just entered one. I have no idea why. Something about a sick art teacher, and I think one school shared art teacher's miscommunication. But excellent posters. There was a landslide by the four top winners. Let's see, the first place was really, I called it really green, because it couldn't get much more green, by Alexis McCarthy from Roosevelt, a fourth grader. So there's our first place winner for the contest. Our second place was Globe and Stripes with a Sun by Stephanie Green from College View, who's second place. Third place was Keep Calm by Caitlin Arnold from Rue Elementary, also a fourth grader. And fourth place this year was The People Around the Globe by Emmett Schmidt from Lewis and Clark. So all from Council Bluffs Public Schools this year, all fourth graders and all girls. I don't know if that says anything, I'm just saying. That's how it worked out this year. It's been a little more diverse in other years, but like I said, the landslide winners were by a landslide. The first place, remember, gets $1,250. Second place gets $1,000. Third place gets $750, and fourth place gets $500. And those will go to the school's art departments. So we'll distribute those usually the day before the Celebrate CB Parade. The posters will be on the truck. They'll debut at that Celebrate CB Parade. And if any of you want to walk with us in the parade, we would love to. We used to get Matt to walk, but I don't know that he can do that anymore. He probably has other obligations.
Too old.
But we would love to have any of you walk with us. Do you have any questions about the contest this year? Go green to keep CB clean.
So do the kids know yet, or
this was the first announcement. I'll send out an email to the art teachers tomorrow.
Okay,
so.
And then so the school gets money, and mm-hmm. the children get their posters on the
trucks.
And
yep.
Do they get money as well?
They don't. They just get recognition. They get to walk in the parade with us.
Okay.
I can't remember, did we do a water bottle or something maybe last year? We recognize them. Some years we've even made signs. The printing company actually blows their poster up to a bigger size, and they get to keep that. It's a mini, basically, of what's on the truck with their place and their name and the poster. So they get that, too, which
very
is
nice.
So, yeah, those will be on the truck starting May and then all through the year. So look for them. There'll be a lot of green this year on the trucks. There are Red River trucks with their red logo. May look like Christmas all year round. Thank you very much. We appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thanks. They do a great job down there, and both Tony and Shannon. And thanks for what you do for the Shannon.
Thanks, guys.
We appreciate your support.
All right, review agenda. And agenda, anything on the consent agenda that anyone would have any questions, comments, or concerns on?
I just want to know on the minutes, looking back, we have approved the appointments subject to confirming a residency requirement for the Citizens and Police Board.
They are, essentially that's an ad hoc group that there is no formal resolution or ordinance establishing that body. So essentially it's at the discretion of the council.
We typically just try to make sure they're in city limits, is that right?
I think.
Not always successful, but we try.
I think sometimes you look for people with key backgrounds that kind of apply some of their knowledge to the organization. I spoke with Ralph about that, and that's kind of how this person got recommended.
He was a graduate of the Citizens Police Academy, and so I think the motion was subject to
yes, not being restricted.
That was kosher, and so
yeah.
Anything else on the consent agenda?
Is anyone with regard to three C, one from the county? I was curious as to the. I believe this is the third or fourth time this issue would come up. I was wondering if they could speak a little bit more of their intention of how much of is it a shifting of the parking? Is it adding more parking lots? Do they intend to comply with the city ordinances that would require a certain landscaping?
anybody here?
And I had kind of a question on that as well, just that, you know, what has changed since the last time we denied this in May of 2012? So I was kind of curious.
I know Scott Belt intended to be here, and if he's not here this afternoon, I'm sure he'll be here tonight.
Okay.
And we are just setting up for a public hearing.
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
Anything else on the consent agenda?
I just had a question for Greg, if you happen to know. What? I was just curious. I didn't realize the ICN still existed. I know it's not within his department, but the easement near the interstate for the Iowa Communications Network, since the advent of Faster
Internet. Still exists,
what does
I don't
it do?
Think it gets used very much. I think they use
because I know we took
it piggyback on there to use it for.
The internet's finally caught up.
Yeah.
Because I know we took it out of the library. I didn't know.
Greg's
I thought it went out of business, to be honest.
I think Greg's out sick, yeah.
Oh, is he sick?
Yeah.
I was just curious more than anything.
Yeah, I think it still exists, but you're right, it doesn't get used much. But I think they maybe have some for-profit businesses that rent space on it. How about public hearings? Anything on the public hearings?
It's a request with respect to 4A. There's going to be some information sought as to what we anticipated the construction plans were for 125 West Broadway.
Yeah, did I not send that?
We got a few emails right as we were headed here. I got one that showed that they would probably close a portion
Here's what I know, and I apologize because I started to type it and then it was gone, and I didn't think I sent it, but I didn't have it anymore. And so I talked to the contractor. As some have alluded to, there is a financing gap in what they think the building is going to appraise for versus the money that they have. That is close to a seven-figure number, but they think that they can fill that gap, and their intent was to start construction when the frost left the ground this year. I know there were three things I was going to say. One, in addition to that, I know they talked about losing parking spaces on the street because of outdoor dining. The proposal that we saw did not indicate that they were going to do that. He admitted they had two potential plans, one of which was to have outdoor dining. They'd like to have that, but under the circumstances, it's not their intent to do that at this time. The second thing is that there is unhappiness revolves around the fact that there is a blacktop space now that is being used for parking that will go away. But there are, I believe, 39 units in that building, and there are 35 parking spaces coming off of Pierce Street for the residents of that unit. There are 35 additional parking spaces on street level of the Hunter block, which would allow both public and residency parking there. So for 39 units, there's 70 parking spaces, which exceeds the amount required. I guess the final thing I put in that email that disappeared was that if we, and this was just my thought, if you would wait 2 or 3 years, those units would be occupied, maybe it's 35, would be occupied, and those people would not have access to their parking. They all would be parking on Broadway. So
the email that we got talked about the funding, and they said that they would have that put in place by the end of April. I also spoke by phone with J Development, and they indicated a May 1st breaking ground date. And also confirmed that it was not their intent to stop, impede, or do anything negatively to impact the traffic flow on Broadway. So that's essentially what the email was, but it was, I also called and talked to my phone.
And regardless of what you do on Pierce Street, that will not stop their project.
Right.
They'll move forward.
Right. But there was some concern last time that the project would close Broadway, and that was a question we didn't know. But they've confirmed
and I
it
won't. Asked him, Jim Rohr from J Development, about that and about equipment and about the safety. There were concerns that access into and out of the parking area next to the chamber has line of sight issues and people have near collisions and would there be heavy equipment going in and out? And he said he wouldn't tell me, but he said, I won't tell you, you know, that won't happen.
Right.
And that there would be times, some days, where they may have a couple parking spaces bags so that he could put a crane in there to do something, but
I had a chance just to meet with Julie Stavnik actually right before our meeting, and she had an update, Mr. Mayor, about the outdoor dining. She had indicated, unfortunately, the part of the building that would need to be built nearest the still existing buildings that because of federal floodplain issues, they'll have to actually raise the level of the sidewalk and ramp. So to do that removes the possibility of having outdoor dining in front of the building. The other thing is she did also echo that whether we repave West Pierce at this time or not, they see that as a separate issue, as do I, quite frankly, as to whether they go forward with the project. To me, the issue comes down to does closure of the street now, is the street necessary to close now? The weighing the strengths and weaknesses of doing it now versus later, based on recent construction and the small business owners there versus eventually doing it later and having a lot of folks who can't get into their parking. So it's certainly not an easy choice either way.
I had spoken with Pat Miller a little bit about what the maintenance records would show for East Pierce, West Pierce, and you know what he had told me and what he emailed to me was that East Pierce had a complete mill and asphalt overlay in 06. West Pierce has had no resurfacing. They have had some reconstruction in areas where they've had to do some waterwork repairs or those type of things, natural gas lines and that sort of thing, but it has not been done, whereas East Pierce has, and they have been getting more requests for repairs over there. So I think the maintenance records show that portion of Pierce actually is older and hasn't been remilled or repaired in a while. So
I just had a brief it would seem to me that if we were to remill West Pierce rather than completely reconstruct it, that would meet the concerns of fairness and certainly would be a heck of a lot shorter time that it'd be closed. And that might be a possible idea. I hadn't really thought of that.
I wasn't certainly suggesting that.
Well, I'm just trying to think of a way, you know, and I still think, regardless of when it was fixed, right in front of the hospital is in awful shape, regardless of when it may have been last fixed. And I still think that's a greater need if we're going to weigh things.
I just know the road was closed there for the longest time between the hospital and, say, a Key Line area.
It was.
That must have been redone.
It's awfully patched right there at the three-way stop. In fact, in my vehicle, it was almost hard to stay in my lane, to be honest, at the speed limit. And that's right after, or depending on which direction, if you're coming from the north, you know, that's the ambulances enter that way from Highway 6.
I actually drove East Pierce after your comments in the last meeting, and I agree there is some need there, basically just beyond east of the hospital itself.
Yes. Yes.
Talked to operations today. They are going to look at that area to see if there is some rehab they can do.
Excellent.
I just wanted to comment on the proposal to mill and overlay West Pierce. I think the records indicate, I have them if you want them, that Pat provided. They're not a lot. And I think that's because we're to the point where we're just sustaining the road so it's serviceable. Basically, you can drive it. That we're beyond the point where we can Band-Aid and repair it. It's reconstruct or do nothing, I think, at this point. I don't think we would spend money wisely by doing a mill and overlay on West Pierce. There's too many utility cuts and other things that would come right back through the surface, and we wouldn't have a good drivable surface in a short amount of time. So I'd hate to see us spend that kind of money for only a year's worth of benefit. So it's up to you if you want to redo the street now or later, but I think whenever we do it, it's going to have to be a full reconstruction.
I appreciate that. I do.
Matt, while you're up here, just because we did get that email from today, just on the way in here, talking about how there was a possibility they would close one lane of Broadway during some of this piers from a traffic flow. Did you guys know that when you decided?
I don't know that we looked at that specifically. Just looking at the site plan or the layout and where the work is going to involve, I think it's more likely to be parking stalls than it will be a lane of traffic, but I guess that'll depend on the size of equipment they use and their contractor's methods, so I can't say for sure what will happen. Typically, we wouldn't let a contractor close a street completely for private construction, but we have had lane closures before.
That brings me to my question. That was I noticed in the CIP that there's a project slated for Vine Street Park rehab in fiscal year 14-15, which would mean as soon as the funds clear and you could begin work in June on that. Do you know what the schedule was for that parking rehab?
We're in design now, the plan would be to construct it this year.
Because then my concern is then if you're closing off parking places on Broadway and then effectively remove the parking in the back there on adjacent to Vine Street, then that would appear to be a pretty significant impact upon those businesses on Broadway.
Right. Right now, our intent and phasing is to remove the one existing bay that's furthest to the east and construct the two or three bays back. So we'll be gaining spots with that process. And then the rehab of the old lots will be phased with each bay of parking so that we'd only lose approximately 30 spots at a time in that process. But there would be a few spots lost, yes.
So there could be construction in the parking lot, construction on the Hunter Block, and then construction on Pierce.
And Pierce being potentially closed is a three street at the same time. Yeah. Hopefully, do we have anything on Highway 6 at the same time? I ask only half in jest.
probably not this year. We do have a project that we were awarded a grant from the state to look at the intersection of Kingsville and Broadway to realign that intersection as well as the traffic signals along West Broadway, but that's FY15 funding, so I doubt you'll see any construction this season.
And that certainly does need to be done at some point. I wouldn't disagree with that.
Well, reading his email, I don't know if you were on this email. It says our intentions are to keep Broadway open. We do expect there to be some limited lane closures and inconveniences associated with utility connections and material delivery. And they end it with, as a 100-block property owner, it's in our best interest to keep traffic flowing to our tenants and all the businesses on Broadway. And I think a couple weeks ago when we were talking, I think it was at night, not in the study session, but the fact of making more visible signage or directional assistance to people who think that Pierce is closed so they can get into the businesses. And both of the business owners that were here seemed to be very receptive to having, you know, really maybe going the extra mile and doing extra signage regarding visibility so that the negative impact that will happen will be somewhat reduced or hopefully reduced because people can get to them. Is that possible?
Are you suggesting that the city generate some signs to put on?
Well, whatever we do when we normally have traffic closure, so when, right, you know, Pierce is being reconstructed, if there's, I don't know if we have an extra electronic sign or what we have just to make sure that businesses know that they're open.
I mean, we use standard traffic control signs which don't benefit the businesses, you know, like open to local traffic only, not a through roads, things like that. If we want to do some specialized signs, we can certainly look at that, like Lyle's Tires and whatever the glass company's name is, are open for business. We can do that. We could look at ways to mount those that are appropriate and not a traffic hindrance. The city does also own the lot immediately east of the parcel where those two businesses sit, so we could allow them to put a sign on that as well, which would be at the phase, or basically the end of the construction. So we could put it out in the grass outside of the right outside the construction limits and say something to that effect as well.
Okay.
I think the city would be open to do that. The question would be, and if you guys tell me to do it, I'll do it, is do we make the signs and put them up, or do we just allow them to install them and they actually make the sign say what they want it to say?
I think it was wise counsel, that caveat of when we rebuild West Broadway, I mean, you still have to think of all that too. As every as every business block gets done there, they're going to want similar.
Could we come up with generic? Because local traffic only, I understand, I think, what that means, but I the fact I don't fully know for certain, I mean, can't we say, is there not a generic way that, does the international signage have something? Because local traffic to me sounds like if I live there, I can get there, but I wouldn't assume as a consumer that I could get to the business because I'm not local traffic. I don't live in that neighborhood. Does that make...
Right. Well, is there a generic? We could even maybe come up with something like businesses are open to customers or something, but it won't say... Lyle's Tires. So if they want something like that, that would be a little bit out of the ordinary for us to do.
Specific sign.
No, but if businesses are open, yeah, that's generic enough and that's helpful enough. I wouldn't be confused that, okay, one business is open, the other one isn't.
Right. And I'm not suggesting that we get into their advertising, but, you know, I've seen businesses get very creative and, you know, have construction sales. And, you know, you can imagine with a tire place, you could have a lot of fun with, you know, potholes and other things and come in and get your tires rotated or your tires replaced because of construction activity. They could do a lot of things and they could almost build it into their advertising program to talk about the construction activity and make people aware that they are open for business.
Anything else? Thanks, Matt. Anything else on the public hearing?
I'm sorry.
Well, go ahead. I have something on C if you've got something.
Oh, I did as well. So.
Oh, okay. I was just going to ask, or just for confirmation. So, is the city, how much money is the city out, if anything? I kind of lost track on this because we've had it before us multiple times. Are we out any money? I'm guessing we are. I don't know why I'm looking at Dick. Sorry, I should have been looking at you.
Go ahead, Dick. I think our total cost to date have been net cost are $66,000. That includes acquisition, demolition. We had one sale, which reduced that, but or $33,200 per lot.
Do I have it correct that we would, in essence, subsidize each lot to $25,000? Would that be CBDG funding? Or I'm sorry, I may have taken your question.
That's how we did. That's how we paid for it, as CDBG funds.
Okay.
And the intent is to sell the properties for $25,000, carry the paper on that, go through the cost estimates. Right now, we have cost estimates of around $115,000. Per each unit, that is the labor and materials per each unit. That does not include the developer fee, which we would give probably 10%. And keep in mind, the developer fee would go to essentially CHIC for, you know, their operations. Also within that developer fee are scholarships that actually go to the building trades students at Iowa Western Community College. There's probably a 6% sales commission, maybe. So at best case scenario, we'd probably get half the cash back, but it all depends upon ultimately what they incur in costs, whether they have sale commissions on it, or whether they sell it themselves. And when they're all done, we'll document all that.
I know there was some talk in another location about having the students at the college was it two houses a year? And in essence, quite a bit of the work would be done as part of their education. The students would be building it. Is that what this is?
Yes.
Well, certainly something to, furthering the education of local students in the trades and building the houses of the future of our community. That is worth something, quite a bit.
And then the tax dollars that come from the homes that are...
Yes.
Yeah, I think for the most part, maybe with the exception of some trades, it would be all the labor would be thrown.
Sure. I imagine some would be somewhat specialized for students. I'd imagine some of it would be somewhat specialized for students. They wouldn't be building necessarily 100% of everything.
No, I think there are certain things that they do have to retain the contractor for.
Sure, that makes sense.
And they do build a good product.
Yes, they do.
So that you expected to receive half back, you said that's half of the $25,000?
That would be the best case scenario.
Okay.
Zero to half.
Got it.
Depending upon their cost.
Any other questions? Thank you, sir. Any other questions on the public hearings? How about ordinances for first reading?
Question on C, 5C. In the write-up, there was some reference by one of the comments of there was mold and asbestos and lead paint in this building.
Yeah, that was a comment from a neighbor.
I don't
know that. And then I think the follow-up was that she met with the owner and no longer had that concern, but...
Okay.
That was my elementary school. I'm still alive.
It turned out all right, so...
Had a bad cough, but... Yeah, I don't know that was...
I'm sure it does have lead paint. I mean, it's old.
Yeah. Anything before, what, 78 has lead paint in it, I mean...
Well, it's just that the comment was put out there,
and there was
no response to it whatsoever. So
sure.
I'm thinking, oh my God, the wrestlers are going to be subjected to mold, spores, and asbestos. And
can I piggyback on that? Are we agreeable to staff recommendation? I'm inclined to agree with going with option one, like the commission recommends. It seems to me to make sense in this individual case, as opposed to completely changing that whole zoning designation.
Fine with that.
Well, we would be changing the zoning designation only for that big particular piece of property, would we not? Because that looks as though it was an add-on to that overall commercial district.
That is correct. It's kind of the issue we have with public buildings once the school leaves them, trying to make them fit in. And
right.
Running into it.
And so they've come back a number of times asking for a new. So I'm wondering if... Given that the building is most likely going to be always some type of commercial use, whether or not it made as much sense just to remove the contract zoning element on it, to take option two, but I didn't see that as part of the draft ordinance.
To go with a full C2 outright zoning of that parcel opens up a lot of uses that I don't think the neighborhood would be very comfortable with and may not fit in well. And like I said, it'd be outright uses. I'd have to go back to the laundry list of C2, which I don't have in front of me. But there are a lot of things you can do in C2 that you may not want to have in going into this formal public building.
But the other properties in the area that are already zoned C2, have there been concerns expressed about those businesses? I mean, just looking at the Google Map overlay of this area, I mean, it looks to be fairly conducive to general C2 activity.
There's houses behind it.
Oh, that's the contract. It's not fully inclusive. Oh,
C2 includes a lot more than that.
Oh, thank you.
It's a mixed neighborhood there right now. There are, I don't know how many houses there are
a lot.
In the area, but...
A lot of them are grandfathered, aren't they? A lot of the businesses along the highway there?
Probably prior to annexation, some of them.
I think...
Okay.
The pipe place, I'm not sure if it's pipes anymore, but I thought I remember reading something in the communication about it being before the city annexed it in, I think, 1969 or whatever it said.
Well, option one clearly gets the landowner where they want to go. I just was wondering if maybe we could cut down on the future requirements.
Yeah, it is interesting. The developer bought the building, zoned as it was, and seems to continually find potential tenants that don't comply with the current zoning, and then asking for a variance from.
Right.
And I don't know if he's never get, if the tenants never happen.
I think that just, well, it's.
You know, it was going to be a storage last time. Was going to be a storage.
Yeah, we storage.
That was.
I think it just never.
The last 12 months.
Fair. And then we removed the bookbinding industry. I think last time was the trade in essence.
Yeah.
And I feel like if we went with a straight up commercial, then he's going to want some type of adding more things to that zoning, more uses for that zoning. And I don't think it's going to change how many times he'll come back with different potential uses. So.
And a wrestling club seems awfully specific, so let's hope that.
They own one now, or running one, or somewhere else right now, I think. So I think it's actually probably really going to go.
I think they do, actually, yeah.
Yeah.
I think they do.
Marcy, maybe you already caught this, on the these ordinances, 6206 is labeled 6204 and vice versa, and I mean they're really messed up.
Right.
Did you already fixed that?
Yeah, that was changed, and then you have a copy of the ordinance regarding 6204. 6206 is the one for the site development regulations.
6206 is, and 6204 is this one, C2.
Yes.
Buddy following that?
Clear as mud, yes.
So going back to then 6204, which is 5C.
Yep.
So option number one seems to be the way to go. I'm trying to find it.
I'm going to stick with words. they seem safer.
I mean, is there another option to make no change?
There certainly is that option.
Then I thought the second option was just to take the contract zoning off of that and then have it zoned as C2, identical to the other properties in that area.
That's how I read it.
So the uses of, if we did that, if we did option two, then all the uses in those in that entire vicinity would apply to a indoor recreation. Am I correct on that?
Well, there are houses to the north and east, and as I understand it, C2 would allow a lot more things that I believe those folks might be
you could put up,
far more objectionable than a little kid's wrestling league, which I doubt offends anyone.
Bar there.
Hmm.
You know?
I'm sorry?
This is from a residents might eliminate a liquor license.
A place for a bar.
Definitely have a package sale would be permitted.
Are you going to help clear this up?
Bring up bars.
I don't know if I'm going to clear it up or not.
Face west.
Well, I mean, this goes back to when they originally rezoned it. I mean, I think staff is okay with either option. The council, previous council, was concerned, I think, with construction materials, so they had the contract. So it really kind of is your discretion. If I quickly went through the uses, if you just designated this C2, these are the uses that I see that would be permitted that are not permitted by the contract. Automobile repair, automobile service establishment, building material and retail sales only. Business services. We're not going to allow a club or lodge. We're talking about commercial indoor recreation now. A contractor shop would be permitted. A cultural service. Oh, no, that is already permitted. Hotel or motel, but I don't think that's very practical. A kennel, commercial kennel. Pawn shop. We do allow printing and binding and mail operations for 50,000 square feet or less, but I don't think the site is capable of handling that. Restaurants. Ones with drive-ins in and limited or general restaurants. Let's see. Interestingly, we didn't, you could have retail there. You could have a secondhand store, tattoo parlor. You could have a tavern, but it's too close to residential district, so you couldn't do that. Veterinarian service and funeral services. So.
Quick question. But this, the way that this went out to the adjoining property owners was just to add something to allow him to do indoor recreation. So
that would be correct.
So if the count, I mean, I still think that's the way to go with this particular property. But if the council were to decide to just make it commercial zoning, don't we have to send something back out to the neighbors since they need to be notified that, hey, by the way, this isn't what we told you was going to happen?
It seemed to be fair play. I think Dick is probably going to say legally. What would you say, Dick?
Yeah, if you expand upon what's been presented to them at this point, it definitely has to start over again.
I would think, because, you know, right now they're not here to protest because they don't have a problem with, you know, a wrestling team. But if you were to change this to commercial, straight up, you say they might have something to say about that.
So option two is not really an option at this point. Okay.
But it's already C2, though.
It's a contract C2.
It's a contract, yeah.
It's been limited.
Limited C2. It was actually sent out to the abutting property owners, but I assume it was limited to the what was being requested. I cannot attest to that.
So essentially it needs to be option one or nothing.
Or start back through the process if that's not what the council wants to do, but I just don't, you know, I just think the neighbors might have had more to say about it if the contract was being removed, so.
Sure.
Any other questions on that? Any other questions on ordinances for first read?
I have a couple for B and D, but did anyone else have any for A? On B, I was just curious, is this responsive, or are we changing to go with best practices? I'm having a hard time, distance is not my strong suit, so I'm having a hard time of understanding why we would do it. I'm not saying I'm against it. I just don't know if I fully understand it.
This is 5B.
Yes.
This is the one with the height, additional height in an I-2 zone. Essentially, there was a request for us to consider this. I looked around. There are several cities that have similar types of allowances on larger parcels and when you increase the setback, which is what's being proposed here. And so it's somewhat of a proactive move on the city's part at this point to not disallow something that other communities and populations think are appropriate.
And it requires 50 acres.
That's quite a size.
So it's, there's maybe one business that it applies to.
Yeah. Thank you. I just curious.
Name shall never be spoken in public.
It applies to names.
I know it does. Just can't say their name.
Oh, no, Mid-American Energy.
Oh, I thought it was Google.
Hey, did say
well, not, no, I
yes.
did. Now
you
made me do it. See how I am about even secrets?
Project Z?
We ran into the same issue with the Mid-America plan.
Yeah.
With their stack, which is unique. So to do that, we did a variance that's probably not the best way to handle those issues.
On 5D, we last week we got some, or earlier this week, I can't remember, we got some emails from some individuals that were opposed to this, and then today there was another email saying the individuals were met with and no longer have opposition, but I didn't get anything in writing. Did you?
I didn't get anything in writing. I got verbal statements that they're had reached some agreement on.
But was it a verbal statement from the developer or from the people who opposed it? Or
the opposition.
Oh, okay. All right. Very good. Thank you.
I think that the developer is going to get us something in writing, correct, before the public hearing?
the one thing, I certainly don't want to hold up this particular project because it's been in the pipeline. It seems like a really good one and a good use. I think as we go forward, I want to float the idea that that whole generalized MAC area, if you will, I know we've talked about it occasionally getting all of the various stakeholders, the city, the Iowa West Foundation, each of the casinos, and all of the business owners, or at least representatives of the different types of business, because I'm not certain long-term, it's somewhat ad hoc, and certainly it's not the fault of anyone. I think it's just the way things happen. I don't know if we really have a plan for the present going forward as to should trucking go here, should this be for, like, if you want me and my niece to go see Sesame Street or something at the MAC, is putting trucking next to it, particularly in a car versus a big truck, and neither will be particularly comfortable in that, just driving South 24th gives you that. I feel like we need to have a plan going forward, so it seems to me that perhaps a self-imposed moratorium on more zoning changes down there until we figure out what we want it to be. I have an open mind about it. I don't know, but each and every project, I think, is going to lead to an ad hoc that it might not make sense overall eventually. You know, we're not kicking out existing uses, of course, but as we plan for the future, do we want to keep making the area, it's fairly schizophrenic. I can't think of another way to put it.
I get that on the MAC, but I think, in my opinion, this is farther on down the road enough that it's more delineated in my mind. But I get what you're saying, because that's just sort of a haphazard. It is.
Yeah.
We've inherited it, so to speak.
Yeah, and I get the impression, and maybe Matt can speak to it. I suspect folks thought maybe there'd be far more, like retail, consumer retail might take off. And then the casino, you know, when all of that came in and people, you know, can't predict the future, was there thought that that might be like where Metro Crossing, instead of where it went, it might go there, it might be other?
Well,
that would make sense.
Yeah, and a little bit of what Lynn's saying is true, and a lot of what you're saying is true, and that when they chose that site, for the Mid-America Center, there were existing industrial uses throughout the area, and so there really is no economic way for the city to go in and relocate all those industrial uses, and so you've got a little bit of industrial on the left side of the street and entertainment and on the right side of the street, which gets that schizophrenic feel you're talking about. As far as trucking businesses, I think Mike Dellinger described it the best, I thought, when he said you want your trucking businesses near the interstate exit so that trucks aren't driving through your town and disrupting traffic. And Wayne's up there, and I'll let him speak because he certainly doesn't need me to defend him. But, you know, this is not a trucking business.
No. I don't mean to imply.
By tractor-trailer trucking, lots of activity in and out. They sell tractors and I think Wayne thought maybe 6 trips a day of somebody test driving a tractor, which isn't going to be a big hindrance. But Wayne
Huvestal, 1641 South 186 Circle in Omaha, and I came up to answer the two letter. You have two letters. One from America. Well, you have 3 letters that I know of. But I talked to Monty at Ameristar for a considerable amount of time. And also with the Value Place owners, investors group, something. And in both cases, they've told me on the phone that they are not against the project. And I've requested for them to comment to their letter. And I expect to have that sometime soon. But I just thought through all the back and forth, I talked to Monty, I think Thursday or Friday, and the Value Place people just mid-morning today. So I think I will get something on that. So that's what I came to. Is there any other question there?
How many new jobs would this bring to the community? I know you had a sheet, so that people who haven't seen the sheet will know.
our office currently is close to, we have about 50 office people, and the office building that we're building is built to kind of handle about 100. So that's kind of what we're, the range we're building for. We have about, currently in our shop, we have about a dozen, and that probably would only go to maybe 15 techs that doing work on trucks. So the so total by the time this gets built is probably in the 65 to 70 area, and we expect that probably all the almost all the growth there would be office. Most of it is office now, and our current office is downtown Omaha, and so that's what would be moving there.
By office, you mean more professional level type
jobs? Well, it's our corporate office, which is credit, collections, marketing, IT, accounting, customer service.
And then, which would certainly,
can you speak? Sorry.
I'm sorry. Certainly, as to property taxes and the increased number of people employed, it sounds awfully, awfully exciting.
Can you speak to the?
Well, I think so too. Thanks. Sure.
Can you speak to the probability of? I know in our previous, our preliminary meetings, there is an additional piece of ground there that would potentially be developed for business park office use, which Council Bluffs sorely needs. Mm-hmm. So could you speak to the probability of that becoming reality?
You know, I don't have something in my pocket right this minute.
Yeah.
I can tell you that we although it has happened, but we would strongly prefer not to be landowners. And we are buying the 29 acres. What we're building on is about 13 or so, and including the pond is probably 2 acres of it. But so the 16 acres that I think is most likely to be, you know, maybe I think it could fit for fast food. I think it could fit for a lot of different kind of uses. I think some more office use. I think that 16 acres is still a large chunk of ground that can handle a lot of different things on it. And so my hope with the purchase of the whole thing is, you know, with some development, get the road in, it'll be, I think, easier to visualize somebody that, you know, maybe building a office warehouse thing or like I said, fast food or those things like that. I think it'll be easier to visualize, which I think will make it easier to develop, sell. So, but I don't have something that I can say I think this is going to happen today.
So quick clarification on access on 14th Street. Yeah, I believe that you're going to build, 16th Street, that you're going to build a access road to your facility. On that, did I understand that correctly?
No, it's 30. Isn't it 35th?
Well, the 16th Street comes off of 35th to your particular property.
Yeah, I think our plan was there's a on the drawing that you have. There's a the city already has the access to go both directions, and there's double turn lanes there, mm-hmm. which is about halfway to, if that's 16th Street. Is that right?
Yeah.
It's about halfway out, and there's already currently double turn lanes.
Right.
And our thought was that would be that we would build a street there that would go pretty much straight to our to the office building. So it would be we'd be building a street south of the Value Place Hotel.
Yep.
And that would go pretty much straight to the office building.
Well, that was going to one of Mr. McKeever's concerns, was whether or not that would be a public street, a city street, that traffic going into Value Place or other businesses possibly on his property would have access to. So I don't know if you know the answer.
Well, yeah, I don't really know the answer. I mean, there's we I think the way it's drawn, there's somewhere between 150 and 180 feet between that, the kind of proposed street and the other property to the north. So it's kind of narrow. So if I'm, I want to do, I do not want to be a landowner there. So I'd love to see it developed into, if there's something that Mark has that could work and make sense. We don't need the road. I mean, I think the way it's set up, I think, right, I don't have somebody else saying, waving their hand to pay for that road. So I think that's us. And I'm, I have no, you know, I hope to use it to the south, to the north. And so, and it'll be a full road because there are some trucks, so it'll be a full it'll be a full size road that we're going to have to build there.
And I understood where Mr. McKeever was coming from.
Sure.
Having acquired that property as a SPC, he wanted to make sure that, you know, he had access from both directions, so he didn't become more of an island than he already was. So that seems very fair. I appreciate your answer.
Thanks.
Anyway, I think Matt's right, and I think Len's right with the point of, you know, not this particular project. I just bring going forward, you know, should the MAC area, should planned commercial be as large as the current map is? Probably not. But I think we kind of need to have that discussion at some point so that it makes it easier and more consistent is all I'm saying. It's nothing to do with this particular proposal. As I read it, this proposal is a fantastic inclusion of a lot of office jobs and the building of and rebuilding of trucks for owners and operators. It's not taking in outside work. I'm not suggesting it's going to be semis in and out. It appears to be the farthest from that as it could
be. Yeah, it's not that.
Yeah.
It sounds, we don't know if we're a truck company or a finance company because we finance every one that we sell.
Yeah.
And so, which is the kind of the reason for the large amount of office staff. So.
Well, the other thing I like about this is, even though, I mean, PC, the city has, you know, more of a hand in the design and the look, and we're rezoning to I-1, but in the development agreement, there will be those certain aspects of landscaping and building materials. So I do appreciate the fact that will that conversation is happening and will continue to happen, and the building's going to be a good-looking building, and there's going to be landscaping. So that's great.
And we want all that too.
Sure.
Just to finish the comment on the office jobs, there are three other locations besides this location, but this is all of the admin, all of the credit collection, everything for all of it is here. So, any other?
Not to keep you up there, but I want to piggyback off of a point that Mr. Watson was making about access, and noting that we're trying to encourage more development like yours, possibly in the area, not necessarily adjacent, but in that area. Noting that currently there's no through access on 14th or 16th Street or even Nebraska Avenue that loops back down to 24th. It really provides trucking and potential industrial sites access, except to go up that rather unfortunate route. And so that might be something to look at, because there's a lot of undeveloped property in that particular area, and it seemed like that providing some street access might encourage some industrial activity that's not currently possible.
Potentially reminds me a lot of the Des Moines area north of the West Mix Master, where 235, the freeway starts, as the Interstate 80 kind of curves to the north and then east in Clive and Urbandale, where you have a lot of use of, you've got commercial, you have light industrial, you have a nice mix of all these things and retail, and there's a plan to it, and it can be done, and it's exciting, and it's exciting that you want to be a part of it.
Thanks.
Thanks, Wayne.
Hey, Nick, for clarification on this, we are making it subject to, I mean, the rezoning's going to happen only with this development, correct?
On all the site approval and what have you.
Again, I'm asking the wrong person.
You're not giving down any credit today.
Sorry.
Well, that's up to you. It's really up to you. I mean, I think the important part to understand here is 5C is tied to
7B.
7B.
7B. There's no reason. I mean, you can take action on 7B. I would probably, let it go ahead and set the hearing on the rezoning and then make delay action on the subdivision until you have the public hearing. You may or may not want to change what we put in the subdivision and the subdivision agreement. And the reason why you have a subdivision in front of you is, I think you just heard they had 26 acres, something
yep.
like that?
Yep.
In our initial conversations with them is that we knew the land use would be an issue and that we recommended and they staff recommended that if they were going to pursue this, that they pursue the northern half. So if we're going to do that, then you have to have a legal description to attach the rezoning to. So thus, you've got a kind of a replat of that parcel into two parts. And it gives us the opportunity then, or gives you the opportunity to put some parameters on the subdivision agreement, which, you know, you normally would not have in a rezoning. So why we did it that way.
Thanks.
Dick, if we were to approve tonight 7B, wouldn't it in effect still need to be contingent on the ordinance going through to
rezoning?
So, but would a delay make any legal difference? Would it change? Would it?
We've done it at a couple projects, and I think that is a smart way to deal with this. So you're essentially okay. the approval night is the approval night, and okay. both things get signed off on at the same time. Something comes up at public hearing that kind of you hate to have one thing already done, and so I would recommend you go ahead and postpone.
Okay, thank you.
So, okay, to the third reading then.
Well,
or second reading?
I'll just postpone it to the next meeting because if there are no objections at that point,
then we're good.
Go ahead and waive third and pass it in law.
Got it. Mm. Okay. Thank you.
I'm Ryan Glenn of Peterson Law. I just want to address a couple comments that were raised with respect to Mr. McKeever. I'm here today to represent Property Investments Incorporated and Mr. McKeever in this rezoning and subdivision application that's before you. Although we still do have some strong concerns with respect to the overall plan and the rezoning to away from the C2, we are in discussions with the developer to attempt to alleviate some of those concerns. However, I do think it's important that the council still take into consideration some of the issues that you've raised here this afternoon, such as the access and inserting and mandating that the developer put the new road as a public road and at the developer's cost in order to do that to benefit the adjacent property owners. I think that's extremely important in order to make this project go forward. In addition, I think that, I think it was Nate that mentioned that the future uses that could be before you by someone else, as Wayne indicated, that they don't intend and like to be landowners. I think that a covenant needs to be attached to the remaining property to make sure that the remaining property remain as C2 so that this isn't a continual problem and impacting the adjacent property owners to make Property Investments Incorporated end up being the only C2 parcel that's in there, affecting, you know, a spot zoning issue that would be brought before you.
PC, right?
It's PC.
It's PC.
PC.
Right.
It's not C2, it's PC.
Or, excuse me, yeah, sorry.
Okay.
So I just wanted to bring forward to you those few comments here this afternoon, and I'm sure we'll have more to say later tonight. Thanks.
Thanks, Harry.
Nick, is the agreement as currently drafted, or is there any other law or provision that would do anything but make that road public?
I was just reviewing the subdivision plat, and I'm not sure what the intent was at this point. Just indicates a proposed ingress and egress and utilities, but I'm not seeing anything about dedication to the city. Are you familiar with
I suppose that might be something for the developer, the owner to consider whether he would dedicate it and perhaps consider the covenant onto the remaining piece of property to remain PC.
But would we want the road number one?
You're not changing the zoning on, away from PC.
Yeah, we're leaving that one.
Yeah.
No, but I think she wants a covenant that it couldn't be undone later contractually.
Wouldn't the street be similar to like a street at Metro Crossing or something like that? That it's part of the development, not belonging to the city.
Well, we left it open. I think what she was speaking to are several terms. She was speaking to many things, but I think in the road we put in the subdivision agreement. Secondary access shall be installed and constructed to city standards for public improvements and dedicated as a public or as a private and or public street. So we left it open.
Okay.
I mean, it'll have to be built to city standards.
Right.
But it doesn't necessarily need to be dedicated.
It sounds like they want it developed, so they're going to want the street open anyway. I mean,
well, just because it's private doesn't mean it's not going to be open.
Right.
The question becomes of the remaining acreage. Some of these situations, it lends itself to be a private street, but. You know, that is for, that's something for you to consider right there.
Can I comment?
Sure.
Okay, so we've had this discussion, and we talked about it for 20 minutes, and I wasn't sure what the right side of it was, so you tell me. That's how we ended it up. And the reason is, or at least some of the reason was, how do you turn off from it? Who's doing what? Who's taking care of it? You know, it got on, and it's like, okay, do you want it or don't you want it? So I don't think I have a strong opinion either way. I own the land on both sides of it, and on the end, like, you tell me. So is that help or hurt? I don't know. Thank you.
So if I just understand correctly, then since there are negotiations, I guess, ongoing,
clearly,
and this is the first reading of the ordinance, if there are parties come to loggerheads about that, I would imagine that we're going to hear about that in the next couple of weeks.
I would think so. Yeah.
Pretty much. Captures the. Anything else on first reading?
I have a question on. Oh, I'm sorry. I skipped to seven. Never mind.
All right. Second reading. You may consider making it go away. Council thinks so.
Yeah, not to waive third. It doesn't seem controversial. No one's spoken against it.
Mm-mm. Thanks. See you, Hannah. How about the resolutions?
I have something on 7G, unless somebody has something before that.
No, that was my concern, too. I just need more explanation or understanding of what it is. And
sure.
Yeah, I do, too. And Dick, I went online, and I see that the property taxes right now are $3,014. It doesn't really specify what payment in lieu of this tax, so...
It'll be $140. Let me introduce you, Joe Decimo. He represents the Ponca organization here, and he can kind of fill you in on the funds that are available to the tribe for this project and some of the background behind it.
Sure. Thank you, Dick. As the name of the agreement suggests, this is a cooperation agreement between the city and the what's called the Tribally Designated Housing Authority, which is the Northern Ponca Housing Authority. The Northern Ponca Housing Authority is a political operating arm of the Ponca Tribe of Nebraska. And in order to use federal funds to maintain the property, they need to get this agreement, a payment in lieu of taxes agreement, okay? And once this agreement is had, then they can use federal money to then maintain the property. So while it appears as though the county is losing out on a lot of money, there is the payment that is made in lieu of taxes, and then the federal money is available to then maintain the property. I think importantly also, though, this settles only to specifically set forth here in the agreement some perhaps jurisdictional disputes that could arise over the property. The property, again, is owned by a political operating arm of a federally recognized tribe. The property is located in a federally designated tribal service area under federal law. And as such, the tribe and the housing authority certainly can make a very viable legal claim that the city doesn't have any jurisdiction over the property to begin with. And what this agreement does in regard to specific areas, it's this one house I might keep in mind, that's it. That's the only thing that's subject to the agreement, a single dwelling, okay? And if the council were to take a look at Section 10, what this does is in Section 10, it specifies that to those specific areas, then the jurisdictional disputes are ended. And what this says is then those city code sections that are agreed to do apply to the property with certain rights specifically retained by the housing authority. And those rights are largely rights that are having to do with the tribes and the tribally designated housing authority's ability to maintain its relationship with its tenants, who are tribal members. And Dick, you know, I promised Dick I would not provide the council any legal advice, but the one thing I would like to say is that in regard to the internal relationships between a tribal member and the tribe itself, federal law is very clear that the city, state, any locality just doesn't have any jurisdiction over that at all. And what Section 10 does, though, is it recognizes that the city has an interest in public aesthetics, in maintaining right-of-ways, in ensuring that the house doesn't become an area where inherently dangerous activities or publicly noxious activities can occur. And again, the agreement specifically says that city codes as to those provisions are going to apply, allow the city to enforce its codes. And enforcement would take, it's pretty much a two-step procedure wherein the city, if it has a notice of a problem, would notify the tribal housing authority, who has, as the agreement recognizes, a competent and comprehensive maintenance authority that will go out, fix the problem. If the tribal housing authority, for some reason, does not fix the problem, then the city can fix the problem itself and then bill the housing authority for the cost that it is to the city to make sure that the house does not become a public problem for the city. So again, while there is a cut in some taxes for the city, there is some makeup in the actual payment that the housing authority is going to make to the city while allowing the housing authority to use federal money to maintain the property and settle the jurisdictional disputes that may arise between the city and the tribal housing authority as specifically set forth herein. And again, it's just to the single property. That's all that's specified in the agreement.
And if that contract gets breached, the only recourse that the city has would be to go to the tribal council?
No, that's not correct, Mayor Walsh. In section, let's see, I just wanted to call this up here. Section 14, I need to read my Romans better. Section 14 does provide for a limited waiver of sovereign immunity for the city and limited to only to the city against the tribally designated housing authority to bring court action to enforce the agreement. So it would not just be to the tribal council. You could bring an action in court. Of course, the action is limited solely to issues in the agreement, disputes between the city and the tribal housing authority.
My focus was not on the jurisdiction.
Yes.
My focus is on the fact that the city is continuing to be obligated to provide city services, police, fire, et cetera, et cetera. Right now, we have a little over $3,000 that is generated in taxes against those city services, and you're proposing to take that away and pay the city how much money?
Well, that would depend. I mean, there is $150 or a maximum of 5% of the difference between shelter rent and total rent, which is, I couldn't tell you exactly how much that would be. It could change it depending on the year. Shelter rent is also defined in the agreement, and I would refer you to the definition of the agreement.
I think what you have to kind of recognize at this point is that this is essentially a government's property.
We can't.
I was like, cause what could happen? Oh, sorry.
And our hands are extremely tied, and we have a good faith obligation to negotiate these agreements, and those agreements have to be within the confines of what the federal government says they have to be.
So it's already not paying taxes, Dick, then?
What I see on the POTCO website in tax money, that's actually not coming to the city?
Well, it comes to city, county, and school district. But once this agreement's in place, that does not happen. Only the funds that are agreed to in this agreement come through.
I think the quickest and most delicate way, brushing over of about 700 years of North American history, is the federal government recognizes certain Native American tribes as sovereign nations for certain historical reasons, shall we say.
I get all that.
We don't have the power to void them.
No, I'm not there. All I'm asking is, because I went to the POTCO, yeah. I saw there was a tax dollar amount.
Yeah.
Is it being paid now?
Yes,
are we losing that? So now, okay, and I don't know why
they're
I'm
getting taxes
about it.
They're current on their taxes. No, we will not be paid that.
But they're agreeing to do it voluntarily.
No, I understand that. So, okay, so they've been paying taxes all along.
It really
and they
wouldn't be
have
much
been.
Different than the local Lutheran church buying a home.
Right.
And not
that's
having,
absolutely
yeah.
correct. In fact,
okay.
Iowa law statute
yeah,
specifically envisions
there.
An exemption for Indian property.
Except
so.
Due to historical reasons, shall we say, the Lutheran church doesn't quite have the claim to sovereign based on certain things in history, shall we say, that... Native American tribes would have.
Yes.
So essentially, right now, if they wanted to, they could take us to court and not pay anything from this point forward.
Of course, they don't want to do that, but that is a possibility.
No, and I get all that. I just, for my own confusion purposes.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Because I saw a tax dollar amount
yes.
on the website, so I assumed it was being paid. That's my
yes.
question.
That's
nothing
right.
to do with history.
No.
It's to do with this.
Foreign,
yes.
certainly.
Yeah. No, it was the dollar amount I saw on my computer. That's it.
That's why this is a cooperation agreement.
I understand all that.
And I'm not so concerned about the tax dollars. I just want to make sure we can abate a nuisance if that were to occur.
That's correct. The only real limit on that is that the city does have to provide notice to the housing authority first. Provide them the opportunity to fix it. They have I think almost 100 properties around the state and through other states, and they have a very comprehensive, very competent maintenance authority that fixes this stuff for them. And to the extent they don't, you guys, the city, can go and fix it and bill them.
Well, they probably don't want their renters to live in an unsafe environment. Anyway.
No, absolutely not.
So I don't
think any of this is going to be a problem. They maintain
no.
their houses in very good order.
All we're doing by this agreement is maintaining the respect to the Native American tribe that federal law gives them for those historical reasons. I mean, there's no way that we could enforce it otherwise, in my opinion. And, you know, if for them to give us the power of a limited waiver of sovereign immunity to go to the courts of our jurisdiction, that is Iowa,
mm-hmm.
is quite a concession
yeah.
that we wouldn't get if this were forced. That is, I don't see that often. And so I'd like to thank you for doing
yes,
that.
Yes, thank you for the recognition, Mr. Watson. And this issue is pretty much controlled by federal law. Mm-hmm. So it's about just getting along.
Yeah, and don't misunderstand my question.
No, I did not. You're losing some tax money, so an explanation is in order.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else on the resolution?
We have some questions relating to the CIP, which is agenda item 7A. And first question, I guess, the staff proponent of that is Mr. Gross, but the question's made.
Why don't you ask Dick?
Okay.
Fine.
Sure.
I eventually will.
Should we go through the should we get all of the ones with less questions out of the way first, just to get them? May I suggest that?
Do
you have any objection?
No.
Okay.
Just so that certain staff who, I think so that, quite frankly, they wouldn't have to stay. Would that be agreeable?
Most of the questions are going to be for, Mr. Cox and.
Sure. Completely understanding and appreciating, yes, that.
I just hesitate to do that.
Oh.
Only for the fact that last time we did it, the questions were for the fire department, who is no longer here.
Well, I think we'd all have to agree that once we stop talking about that, we stop talking about that, I guess. We'd have to, if we're not agreeable to that, then just stick to normal order.
Yeah, let's just dive in.
Okay.
Sure.
All right.
Yeah, I hate to let people go and then have somebody not here that.
And it's, I don't have a,
sure.
a lot
no,
of questions
no.
with respect
Fair
to
enough.
First question, as it pertains to police headquarters on page 22. Notice that $13 million is funded for the construction of a new headquarters. $8.5 million is financed with general obligation bonds. I guess my first question is, have those bonds been authorized yet?
Those bonds haven't been authorized.
I didn't think so.
It would require a vote of the public and would be a 60% approval.
Very good. And the other funding associated with that, I was wondering where that was anticipated to come from. Is
Art's not
Art
here.
Left team is
Art some is anticipated from some type of settlement from the county if they were to take over.
Oh,
The location.
If we give back the space we currently have in the county building, there is something that we. There's some consideration we receive if they gain the entirety of that space.
Okay.
I think the one thing I would say, I'm not trying to say don't look at all 5 years. We prepare a capital improvement program each year. Adoption of a resolution basically is essentially an authorization for the departments in the first year to start proceeding. In fact, a lot of these, they've already proceeded. Because we were late, because we had the mayoral election and a lot of changes. So we're delayed. Second year, third year, fourth year, fifth year, it's not an authorization. You're going to see that again. It's really more of a programming guide. It's a way for Larry Foster in the Parks Department or Matt Cox and Greg Reeder in the Public Works Department to kind of program a series of projects in 5 years that you just can't express in 1 year. So,
okay.
Different factors will change. For example, that police station has been on there for as long as I can remember.
Oh, it's huge questions.
Never been done.
Yeah, I mean,
not that it won't be on, but
I mean, it is expressed as a need by the police department, and we placed it in. So. There are a lot of questions
okay.
about how we would do that in 2 or 3 years.
So there's no final decision that's been made, even though the line item says new construction could morph into some other type of project if that was deemed advantageous to the city.
Yeah. And
yes. Is it in essence something that is a goal of ours in the future that we want to articulate in some way? It could stay in year five, if you will,
location
for a while.
Again, I would say, look at year one as the
and all that would be
projects that departments will proceed on.
Sure.
That finance ultimately will look at issuing a bond issue at some point in time in the future.
But it's fair to say the stuff in the next year is more serious, if you will. It's more immediate and
yes.
more likely.
Yes.
Approving a plan for next year is more likely that we want to proceed that way as opposed to year five, which is
yeah.
still speculative, but planning to be prudent just in case.
Yeah.
Okay.
Whoever changed the wording on that from the last SIP to this one, I do appreciate that it's gone back to a downtown location. So.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's in the goal, so now that has to all be worked out.
I'm just saying, I was glad to see the wording change.
The other question concerned the West Broadway reconstruction. I saw that was like the first segment from I-29.
I'll let Matt answer that. That's how I would do. If you have a question concerning a particular fire item or a particular CD or Public Works, I'll defer to.
No, it was a question of whether or not this envision it had the $5.5 million worth of state funding.
Yes.
And so I wondered if this envisioned making that agreement with the state of Iowa to take over, or if this was a completely different
on West Broadway.
It envisions it.
It envisions taking over the maintenance initially from 16th Street to 36th Street, but in a multi, you know, I'm sure the construction period, 5.5 doesn't touch the number. It's 8 million a mile.
So
that was placed in the CIP for two reasons. One, because of the continuing discussions with the DOT about the transfer of jurisdiction and some sort of financial reimbursement from them for that transfer. Still unknown, you know, very early stages. Because of the need and not knowing where that was going, we also programmed through MAPA using our STP funds a project for FY15 as well, which would allow, we have the available funds by shifting some of our other projects that were listed in the STP to illustrative years is how they refer to it. So again, it's very similar, Nate, as what you were talking about. You put it out 5 years from now. It's really just there to illustrate that that is a need and that there is a want to do that project, but not necessarily that it will happen for sure.
And isn't it also prudent to put it, I suppose, crudely, if we get stuck with the street and no money, and it's not fixed up, we've found a way to figure out how we might deal with that.
At least the first phase.
Fair enough.
I appreciate that. I just saw the source of funding, so that begged the question in my mind, and that's fine. But while you're up there, I guess we could transition to the levee maintenance projects, if we might.
Sure.
And I.
Are we looking in which year?
Actually, what I did is I went through all 5 years and added up the total amount of all those levy maintenance projects, and I came up with a figure somewhere around $17.5 million over that 5 year period. And something caught my eye, and I just wanted to get clarification on it, that all that 17.5 was funded by sales tax dollars. Did I read that correctly?
That's correct. That's how it's okay. Programmed.
So I guess my question would be for Dick, given the ordinance 2.10.10 that defines how lost dollars are supposed to be spent, has there been a formal opinion rendered that use of sales tax dollars would be appropriate for a levy project?
It very clearly can become deemed part of the stormwater system, and of the essentially, or what we have done is the language in the actual ballot. I'll have to go back to 210 because the language in the ballot is what's truly controlling on the council, and that is for the maintenance and improvement of the city's street and sewer systems. That's the ballot language. I'll have to go back and revisit 210 to see what it actually says about.
But perhaps we need to do that because the ordinance that I printed off of the website appears to refer to the language that was on the ballot, and it says maintenance and improvement of the city's sewer and street systems, and goes on to say the provisions of this chapter shall not be construed to mean anything that is inconsistent with the language which was contained on the ballot. And so I wanted to make sure I had that clarified because as I read this, a vote for the CIP was in essence saying that we approved of the use of sales tax revenues for levy projects.
Now, I don't know if it's still there or not, but we used to make some reference to the George Butler study in that chapter as to that's how we would spend the money. And that was a study that was done 20 years ago, I think. And I think we definitely need to update that ordinance to make it consistent with what we're doing today.
Okay. Is there a possibility that we would have to return this to a as a ballot issue to expand the?
In my mind, the levy system, in the internal levies that we have along the creeks and what have you, and that which goes along the Missouri River, I have to believe that's a safe interpretation to say that's part of the storm sewer system.
Gosh.
There is some case law in Iowa on that. I can't cite it off the top of my head, but I've looked at that before. That would support that.
I would really be interested in seeing that because then, you know, going on down to 2.10.30, then talks about the relative priorities of funding consistent with point 10. And then I come back to that last sentence that says that provisions of this chapter shall not be construed to mean anything that is inconsistent with the language contained in the ballot. So even if there were such an interpretation, you're then drawn back to the consistency with what it was that the voters approved of back in December of 1989.
Back then, storm waters were a big issue. That we were, a half inch rain would net about 100 basements filled with water. And that's what they were trying to protect the city against. And that's why when the ballot got approved, was that, because that was about the third shot at it. And that's when they limited strictly to storm and streets, or I'm sorry, sanitary and street systems. A lot of the problem was combination sewers, which was getting into the basements, but there was also a lot coming in over the grounds, over the tops of the curbs of the streets, and into the basement.
So there was some understanding that there was a problem at that point, but when the ballot was approved as a ballot initiative, the language was restricted to street and sewers.
Initially, the ballot at the time, specifically, first failure was to put it into the general fund, and the public voted against that.
And I think there might, was there a second time that failed as well, or not?
I don't remember that, but I don't, it was about, I don't remember.
This ballot was the one that got passed, which had this language in it, in response to a lot of flooded basements and problems in that regard.
And again, just for point of clarification, if we approve it, it doesn't mean, or does it mean that we're approving that we have to spend that money from sales tax?
Not necessarily, because Greg's already identified some other captured state sales tax dollars that we might be able to utilize for this. And if that happens, we could keep this going for other purposes.
And that's a flood program instituted by the state of Iowa that would allow us to capture the state's portion of the sales tax. And so I don't know if that was the
portion answer. Of the state's sales.
Portion of the state sales tax that's, what, 65% of the incremental
I believe it's
increase.
70%.
Dick, am I correct if it came to that, in construing action by a local political subdivision of the state, it would be the action of a elected council would be presumed to be consistent with relevant laws and any sort of state constitutional concerns, if it can reasonably be read that way?
Yes, I think that's safe to say. I think a lot of our guidance on this interpretation will come from the drainage district law in Iowa. That is a body of law that's been well interpreted over the years.
Thank you.
I'm also equally concerned about the interpretation by the voters who approved that sales tax. Along that same line, and I guess this comes back to you, Dick, I noticed that there were other line items as well, the East Beltway project that was also financed by, in part by sales tax revenue. Is there some sort of review mechanism that the city has to routinely review these things and make those types of judgments as to whether or not sales tax can be used?
Whether or not it's right fund. Well, that would be seen as an improvement of the city's street system. Because back at the time that language was put together, there was concern, is it just going to be utilized for the maintenance of existing roads, or are we going to address the entire system? And that's how the language got put in the ballot to improve the city's
system. And one of the changes that took place out at the time was the initial ballot issue talked about sewers, and then at some point the sewers were under the streets, and so then that got changed by, I don't know if it was a second ballot initiative or whether it was just administratively done by the council to change it to sewers and streets above the sewers. And
then the final language that went in the ballot, which was what the council approved, was the street and sewer systems.
Mm-hmm. Right, because there were going to be times when a sewer needed to be repaired where the street didn't, or vice versa. And the way it originally, if I remember it right, was written, well, you had to do the sewer and the street. You couldn't do one or the other, or you couldn't make a repair here and not there. So that's when it came down to.
I may have a working file from that ballot.
Okay, that's all the questions I have.
Anybody else? CIP. Anybody else on other resolutions?
If nobody has anything on the CIP, could I go to 7C? I'm just curious, just as a general question, taking the long view, again, not necessarily this particular project, but, 50 or 100 years from now, when we approve plats without space for parks, I'm concerned that we might get into a situation like, another example would be, for example, in the 70s, when parts of the community were, have no sidewalks and indeed have no gas service because of the 70s, and so they have electric heat. In other words, I think, thinking ahead, we might end up with large parts of our city that may not have parks 50 or 100 years from now. And, things change. For example, when my street was built, it was a very expensive street to live on, and it's less so today by a considerable degree. But that was 120 years ago. And a lot of these streets may still exist in 100 years. And I don't think it's too much to look at the long term of when we approve these sorts of things, should they not include space dedicated or at least reserved for public use? Otherwise, we might end up with huge areas of town that have none. And then the taxpayer will have to pay market rate in 100 years to get them. And that doesn't seem fair.
I think you make a valid point. Yeah, I guess as from an economic standpoint, too, though, I'd like to point out that you're requiring people to reserve large areas of vacant space for stormwater detention areas, and then to require them to put a park in may, in fact, entail that they'd have to plan for 50% of their ground to be dedicated for non-profitable use.
It's not an easy thing. I just raise that because I'm concerned because some might say this area will always remain relatively high value. Well, I would say actually high value, but that's not always true over 100 years. Some areas started out as the regency of town and don't end up that way, and vice versa. And so I just thinking the long view, I'm not sure if that's the right answer at all. I throw that out there as we look at these. I see that we have on our periphery, we have huge areas where this could be a problem in as little as 20 or 30 years. And I don't mean to open a can of worms. No. I just throw that out there.
Certainly more so to the east side of town, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right. And so, it has nothing specifically except to the point that this doesn't have any space like that, but I appreciate there's no requirement to do so, I'm not criticizing it.
Green space over there around the lakes.
Well, yeah, it might not remain that way.
Well, if that is the council's wishes, then we need direction to change the subdivision code to require that as a requirement.
I just thought, when we started land grant universities or towns or homesteading acts, they required certain areas be dedicated.
But let me tell you some of the difficulties.
Sure.
I mean, it has to be tied back to the Parks Master Plan, where they have identified specific areas that they want to have a park. So then you have to deal with the fact that Lynn subdivision happens to have one of those green spots in her subdivision, so she has to deal with it. Sharon subdivision next door doesn't, so she's off scot-free. So we've got to find that equity balance.
Sure.
Which is difficult.
Mm-hmm.
So the other
raise
thing
more
you have
questions than answers, I realize.
And the other thing you have to consider is when I lived on Eastview Drive, John Roth built that, and I think he had 20 lots. And some people say, well, subdivisions should all have a park. Well, how do you do a park in a 20-lot subdivision? Just because of our terrain, most of our subdivisions are relatively small. Now, Fox Run, over time, is a fairly large subdivision. Forest Glen has turned out to be a fairly large subdivision. Hills of Cedar Creek is a big subdivision. But other than those, most are relatively small infill type developments.
I don't have an answer.
You could look at an impact fee, but we really can't charge impact fees. Or can we?
No. West Des Moines tried and got sued and lost.
Okay.
Well, my concern too is that if we ended up with Little Parks and all these subdivisions and they wanted to dedicate them all to the city, you know, I don't think that meets with the master plan. So we wouldn't want that. We wouldn't want every developer putting in a Little Park and then saying, here you go.
But
now we're going to vote to.
But on the other hand, the 47 acres in Fairmont Park would have made prime real estate, and then the public would not have that if we hadn't dedicated that 100 years ago.
Well, that was actually Fairmont Park, if I understand, was actually
a development
that went bankrupt.
It was part of it, yeah.
So it should have got.
Yeah.
But, you know, maybe the most prudent thing would be is to project out your growth, go out before land becomes valuable and purchase it now.
That makes a lot of sense.
But then, well, it makes a lot of sense if you have the money.
Well, sure. You
know, so it's all about money. So.
Sure. I just throw that out as an idea because I think that's something we need to think about.
It's a vexing problem. I don't know that I have a solution for it. I do know, for example, in trails, you know, if we have a master trails plan and there's a trail going through Lynn's subdivision, we're going to require people to put a sidewalk in. Well, maybe we should have a fund to say, well, what would it cost? How much more would it cost to upgrade from a sidewalk to a trail? And actually get that done.
Sure.
Did Hills of Cedar Creek set aside a park area?
What's that?
Didn't Hills of Cedar Creek set aside area for a park?
They did, and typically when they set aside parks land, it's not something
there's
that
a reason.
Typically has the best house on it.
How cynical you are.
Just realistic.
It's done.
Well, sometimes realism is, cynicism is realistic.
Any other questions on that? Mm-mm. Any other questions on the resolutions?
So on 7H, or the sanitary sewer rate study, just had a quick question. What do we anticipate will be the cost of that study? Given the fact, and I appreciate all the paperwork, all the prior work that you supplied me that CDM Smith had done in the past on involved nutrient reduction and this particular one on possible stormwater utility fee. So given all the work that they've done before, which is quite considerable, how much more do you think they're going to have to put into this to come up with a set of recommendations?
Are you asking timeline or money?
A little bit of both.
The dollars, they gave us a range, and I think that was in the memo, $50,000 to $90,000. Some of that's based on the information we provide, so history of revenues, different things that we can break down, and how good that data is, and how much work they need to manipulate that will somewhat drive the cost. Also, there's a number of options we can ask them to the way they look at it, and what services we choose will dictate the cost as well. Greg's not here today, but with my conversations with him, he seemed to indicate we'd probably be on the upper end of that range.
Okay. No, I just thought, given the comparative analysis that they've taken in these other studies, I was just curious how much more data they would require and what the cost of that would be.
They are very familiar with our storm sewer system and our wastewater plant. They haven't done any work directly related with sanitary sewers prior to this study, so they do bring some knowledge to the table, but they'll have to do a little bit of work to be able to make a recommendation.
Typically, these are a five-year plan, so at some point you got to kind of figure out where the sweet spot is so that you pay all the expenses over the next 5 years without overcharging or undercharging.
Right.
Okay.
Any other questions on that one before I go back?
We call you back up.
Other questions on resolutions?
Just
really for him.
Hello. I just had a comment that they seem to be less than normal, and I assume that's attributed to the fact that it's winter, so there'd be no weed, but even the solid waste seemed to be left. But I appreciate that you...
Color coded.
I know.
They did color coded. No, I got an interesting comment today, and I don't know that I fully comprehend, but I had, I've been leaving my door open. Told Vern, I'm not so sure that's a great idea after doing it for about 3 weeks. But
your door at home or your door here?
Door here. Yeah, both.
Get kind of chilly.
And some gentleman walked in and said, you know, I got a delinquent garbage fee. I've never been delinquent before. You switch from semi-annually to quarterly, and he said, I honestly don't remember seeing the bill and, you know, all that. I told him, I said, you know, I just don't have that kind of power where I can just say you don't have to pay and you do have to pay and you don't have to. But in talking with him, I sat and wondered, when we set up that delinquent fee, we did it based on a semi-annual billing, and I think a percent of what the billing was, and maybe that wasn't true, but now we did quarterly, and he said, I got a $50 bill, and I got a $20 late fee, and he says, boy, that seems onerous, and I told him, well, I think when we set it up for the semi-annual billing, and maybe that's not true, so I told him I'd ask.
Or he didn't say semi-annual, it was based on the number of times we actually billed out. So it didn't say semi-annual on that. But I guess that's something that you want us to take a look at, you know, drop it to $10 versus $20. But we're still getting one-third last time late.
Yeah, and I told him that. I said, we do about 300,000 of people not paying their bills. I don't know what it is here.
Just the late fee, there's one-third of the total 19,000 that didn't pay their bills.
On time.
A lot.
Wow.
And I explained, the waterworks can shut off your water. We can't stop picking up your garbage. But he just, and it seemed, when he said, when you got a $50 bill and you got a $20 late fee every month, he said,
when it also too the cost part of it though the other side of the coin is, you know, it still takes staff time. Now it's four times a year instead of twice because of the change in state law.
We figured, Art and I talked, it's in the neighborhood of $60,000 expense to go. Is that pretty close? I know.
Where did Art go?
To send out a bill four times a year versus two times a year.
Over the course of the year.
Yeah.
Probably pretty close. I'd have to check the numbers, but yeah. Probably pretty close.
Because I said that, Art, I said, you know, and when he said we had talked about billing in conjunction with the sewer, in conjunction with the water bill, and he and I said, God, they wanted $30,000 from the waterworks, and Art said, that'd be cheap.
Yeah.
Because the cost of billing would. Yeah.
Well, now there's automated payments.
The gentleman that came to you, he's had three billings that have said quarterly. Three. Is he saying he hasn't seen three of them?
Yeah, I don't know.
And plus there was notices on the bills prior to us switching to quarterly that we were switching to quarterly. There was stuff in the paper. You know, there was an announcement sent out with the billing. So there's been a lot.
Yeah, I told him I couldn't. No. Wouldn't even entertain talking about not paying the late fee, but he just, when he said it's $20 for a $50 bill, I thought, well, we set that when it was a semi-annual billing, and
the expense is still there, though, if they're late and all the extra. I mean, I think the thing is now you really can sign up automatically. You don't even have to do anything. Once you sign up, it comes out every quarter. I mean, how simple, if you really don't want to have a fee, sign up and you're done.
Set it up to come out $18 a month.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, I mean, there's all these choices on there. And it just, once you're, I mean, it's easy.
And if you only have the credit card company $50, they still don't care. You're still going to get the late fees.
That's what I'm thinking. I don't think I should change it.
I just don't.
And, you know, the other thing, too, is as we...
Just bringing it up.
Sure. As we look to the future, and, you know, surely at some point it'll, like everything else, have to go up. There, maybe we incentivize... doing it online, paying online, or we de-incentivize paying it the so-called old-fashioned way.
Well, I wouldn't do that, because there's a lot of people that's, that write checks. I think maybe an incentive for paying it on online or automatic payment that you get a reduction or
I agree.
Or something. I mean, people just need to pay their darn bills, for God's sake.
Not in the near term, but
so
certainly
simple.
Certainly within 50 years, I don't think people are going to be writing checks anymore. I'll make that prediction.
Well,
but yeah, I'm not saying this year. Today.
Yes.
Anything else on the resolution?
Moving on.
Moving on, yes. Quite right.
All right. See you at 7 o'clock.
At Council Bluffs Savings Bank, we take pride in our community, volunteering our time to helping individuals, families, and businesses succeed. We are Council Bluffs people operating a Council Bluffs bank to help Council Bluffs be a better place to work and live. Hometown banking, the way it used to be.